so let me start with the first one, Q1, what I call the ultimate tariff receiver. And this is a question actually that was inspired by a question I got from a student whose question was, okay, we have a tons of technological breakthroughs in digital communications, and you guys are still talking about RF. Why don't you just do something very simple? Why don't you just take one of my super powerful digital processors? I can give you as many of them as you want. Simply put what's called here an analog to digital converter. This is what the ADC stands for. And then stick an antenna to the system, and here you have it. Here is your, I would call the ultimate RF receiver. The antenna will make sure that takes an electromagnetic wave from free space and translates it into some type of a voltage here, right? This is what, broadly speaking, antennas are doing. They capture waves and they transfer them into voltage. This A to DC is going to take that voltage and basically digitize it, and then I can do the rest of my processing with my digital processors. So that's it. Your field is done, and our advancement from digital communication basically in digital signal processing is basically ending RF. Now, the interesting thing about this question is that it's not entirely off basis. In fact, the digital processor people and the digital signal processing people have made such an amazing advancement that have dramatically changed the way we're thinking about RF receivers. In the old days, there used to be three very, very specific parts. There was an antenna, there was an analog system, and there was a digital system. That was the three broad subsystems of an RF receiver. Today, the digital and the analog are actually mixed. In many ways, actually, you can't even tell exactly where the digital begins and where the analog ends. So certainly, their sheer processing power is influencing and impacting how we do the RF design, and that's a good thing. That's the only reason, for example, we can do now 5G communications. Maybe not the only reason, but a major reason. But going from there to say that the whole system can actually be done in the way I'm actually portraying it here is not true, at least today. And so I would like to give you a few reasons why this is not true. So the first thing I'd like you to think about is think about the incoming signal level. So in other words, what is the signal level that this antenna will basically receive? So it varies, of course, right? It depends how far away you are from the broadcasting system, and it depends on what kind of standard you're using. But roughly speaking, let's say, for example, that we consider our GPS system as an example. Actually, sorry, I will change that. Won't go that low for right now. Let's say we're considering a fairly old standard, which is a GSM standard, which is a 2G standard. It was created a few decades ago. So even for a GSM standard, essentially the signal level that we can expect to receive is in the order of negative 100 dBm. Now, for those of you who don't know exactly what that dB scale is, we'll discuss it a little bit later, but negative 100 dBm is basically equal to 10 to the negative 10 milliwatts. Or if you want it in watts, this is basically negative 13 watts. This is the minimum signal level that you can actually receive in a GSM system, right? So let's think about that. You need to design a system that can actually handle, at the minimum, something in the order of less than a picowatt, right? Do you know what voltage that is? Let's think about it. Let's say that we are taking this power, and we are thinking, how much of a voltage would it actually create if it was on a 50-ohm resistor, which is a typical resistance that we will see, for example, in antenna impedances or in receiver impedances. We'll talk about this later on as well. So if you do this very simple calculation, so you say that voltage squared divided by 50 ohms is equal to my minimum signal level, you will find out that the voltage that you're supposed to be receiving approximately is in the order of 2 microvolts. So this is the first challenge that we have to think about. Essentially, if we just implement exactly the architecture I have here on the board, and we call that the ultimate RF receiver, we have to be dealing right at the input of my ADC with basically voltages in the order of microvolts. And for those of you who have taken any digital electronics, it's obvious that this doesn't work. We basically need voltages in the order of volts to basically, or subvolts, to basically make this thing work. You can't just feed it with such a low voltage. Now, you might say, well, big deal. If this is the issue that you're dealing with, if it's the signal level that you have to work that is very, very low, so why don't you just add an amplifier? So right here, go ahead and just after the antenna, put a nice amplifier, and then do the previous thing. So fine, I'll give you that you're going to have my digital processing unit, my ADC, and I'll give you to get an amplifier. Now, how much amplification do we need? So going to my previous thing, I have to basically go from, you know, this low power to basically subvolts. So I need an amplification in the order of, let's say, roughly 100 dBs. Now let's think about it. How realistic is it to make an amplifier, let's say at 2 gigahertz or at 1 gigahertz, very typical RF frequencies, that has a gain of 100 dB? It's totally unrealistic, and let's think of why that's the case. And some of you who have done amplifier design are already smiling. So first of all, it's a very non-trivial task because the first issue that your amplifier will have is efficiency. Right, amplifiers at 10 or 1 or 2 gigahertz, they're not incredibly efficient, right? And in fact, these things get worse if you go to 10 gigahertz, 20 or 30 gigahertz. That means you'll have to spend an immense amount of DC power to actually get this type of a gain. Just from an efficiency perspective, simply doesn't work. You don't want to have a small cell phone and a truck to carry its battery for this thing to work. So just from an efficiency, because again, remember that an amplifier is simply taking DC power and makes it into RF, that efficiency is pretty low. It's usually a few, 10, 20, 30, 40, 50%, depending on the system design, the cost, the frequency, and so on and so forth. The other issue we'll find out if you ever try to make a 100 dB amplification is that this thing will actually be unstable. What I mean by unstable is an amplifier with such an immense gain will actually oscillate. It will basically turn from an amplifier to an oscillator. It will be an unstable system. And for those of you who have, again, taken any signal theory course, such immense gains can't really be realized easily. And so instability will be your another big nightmare. Now, you may say, OK, I'm going to fight instability by actually breaking this amplifier into multiple stages. So how about if I just break this amplifier into 5 stages, and each stage has just 20 dB of gain? Can I live with that? The answer is, again, a resounding no. And what will happen here is you'll have to fight a lot of parasitics. There's going to be parasitic coupling, in other words, from one stage to the next. And just this parasitic coupling will come from the actual layout, the actual implementation. And there's very little you can do about it. You can't fight these parasitics. They're going to be there, and they will actually lead you back to instability. Now, I could think of a lot of other issues, honestly, about 100 dB amplifier. The only thing I do want to warn you is don't go to industry and tell them I'm going to give you a 100 dB amplifier. These are just 3 reasons why you can't do it. And so what we do in real life is we actually break this amplification gain to multiple stages. So we give, for example, an amplifier, not 100 dB here, but maybe 10 to 20 dBs at the first stage right before the antenna. And then the remaining 80 or 90 dBs, we actually get it later on in the receiver chain, as we're going to be discussing, precisely to avoid some of the issues we're talking about here. And the last problem I'd like to mention about this receiver, now that we know that we have all of these issues, is what we just talked about, the dynamic range. So again, the issue with the dynamic range is that you have to handle with the same system very low signals and very high signals. Let me give you an example. If I take my GPS, and I know that all of you have used GPS one way or another, the minimum signal that this GPS receiver must receive is actually about negative 125 dBm. Which, if you translate that, this is actually less than a femtowatt. Pretty scary. At the same time, think about it this way. You're actually going to the airport. You are trying to find where the airport is. Your GPS signal is working from your phone. It says turn left and right, you know, stay, take a break, whatever. And you're basically 2 miles from the airport, and your poor phone is not just getting the GPS signal, but is receiving this blasting signal from the radar that the airport is using to track flights. So now this phone is actually struggle to get this minimum signal to make the GPS work. Remember that the GPS signal comes from a satellite that is several thousand miles away. And at the same time, you're being blasted by an antenna that is actually sending a few kilowatts out to track incoming airplanes. So your cell phone may be struggling with this signal and may be getting another negative 20 dBm at another band, which is fine, but still those bands will be close. So that other band, as I just mentioned, for example, could be a radar signal. If you look at this difference, and this is not unusual, we are talking about something in the order of 100 dB dynamic range. And that's an amazingly interesting challenge. To resolve 100 dB dynamic range with just this DSP here, it would require an unrealistic number of bits at the ADC stage. So the digitization will have to be done so precisely, and the number of bits is so unrealistic that very quickly this ADC becomes too costly and too power hungry. And it simply doesn't work. So these are just three examples, three reasons, and just to review them very quickly. Reason number one, the incoming signal level being too low. Reason number two, adding an amplifying brute force simply can't be done. And reason number three, even if you attempt to do anything like this, you now have to digitize with an amazingly high number of bits that will make your system very hungry power-wise and very costly power-wise. And I haven't even started talking about here many of the other challenges that we have to deal with. For example, we have to deal with intentional interferers. Somebody must be able to defend if somebody tries to basically interfere with your system. And here, there is absolutely zero protection against intentional interferers. All right, so this is a quick introduction for Q1, why we can't just simply stick an antenna to a computer and expect things to work. So if your friends from digital communications or computer engineers tell you that, just take an antenna and put it in front of my computer, here's the reason why we can't do that.